What's up, everybody? Welcome to another episode of whatever we're doing here. 8 days of HalfKocked is our gimmick, I guess. If you've seen a majority of our content, or some of our content, you know that I watch and review a lot of the Netflix original stuff, and a lot of other mainstream critics. For whatever reason, they're too much of a hipster to review that sort of content, so I am here to review it. So when we were talking about our end of the year wrap-up stuff, I figured I would do my top 10 Netflix original movies of 2017. My number 10 spot is going to a film called I Don't Feel at Home in This World Anymore, which was premiered at Sundance. I think it won the Sundance like Grand Jury Dramatic Prize. Melanie Lynskey plays a woman whose house is broken into, and she basically just decides to go on like a murdering rampage to find the people who stole her stuff. And Elijah Wood plays her like really fucking weird neighbor. He's just like, he's wearing these weird glasses and he's just saying like weird stuff. This movie is a super dark black comedy. This had the potential to be higher on my list, but I do think that like some of the villains in the movie just didn't quite work for me. But it's really, the violence is, they use violence as humor a lot, and it really works. Like there's some really extravagant sequences of violence, and Melanie Lynskey is really great. I just love her character. She just doesn't understand why people have to be assholes, which is, I think, something that we can all relate to, and it just showcases it in this sort of violent, murdering rampage, and the movie's just crazy weird. It feels kind of like, you know, when everybody was doing like knockoff Coen Brothers movies, and that sort of knockoff Coen Brothers Tarantino. The dialogue isn't quite there, but I really, really love the performances, and the dynamic that she has with Elijah Wood is great. They have great chemistry. I don't want to spoil some stuff, but I've laughed harder at some of like the weird violent things in this movie than I do in like most mainstream comedies. I think if you have a super dark sense of humor, you'll probably maybe enjoy more than I did. It's one that I definitely should rewatch because I think I will enjoy it more, you know, when I sort of know what to expect. I Don't Feel at Home in This World Anymore. It's a weird title, but check that one out. Our Souls at Night. This movie stars Robert Redford and Jane Fonda, and I guess their first on-screen role together in like 50 years since they've last, you know, been in a movie together. I don't really know why this movie came to Netflix, because this feels like a movie for grandma. Grandma doesn't have Netflix. Like, if this movie came out in like, you know, a wide release, like, there'd be a ton of old people go see it. Because it's basically, it's sort of a romance movie about these two people who have been neighbors for their whole life, and they're both widowers. They fall in love, sort of the last years of their life. They're both like 80. It's a really sweet movie, and you know, if you're not into like, you know, that sort of thing, I guess if you're just a raging asshole, maybe this movie wouldn't work for you. But just like, I don't know, Redford and Fonda are super charismatic, and you're rooting for these characters. It's not like a big flashy movie. That's not like super, like, I was expecting this to be like super dramatic, sort of like a Michael Haneke's More, when it gets like, it's about Alzheimer's and dying and losing everybody you love. But it's just kind of about this sweet movie that's like these two old people who they don't really have anything else to do. They don't really do much with their lives anymore. They just live alone. So it's like, why not form a connection? And it was almost more about that than overtly romantic. Jane Fonda's son is played by the dude from A Bigger Splash, who I can't remember his name, but he's pretty good in the movie. There's a few like revelations made in like the third act that I felt were a little bit unnecessary, sort of tying these two characters' backstory together. But other than that, it's a really, you know, nice movie. It's a nice movie. Watch this with grandma. Yeah. My number 8 was one of the most hyped movies of the year. Not movies of the year, but the most hyped Netflix movies of the year. It's called War Machine. It's directed by David McCod, who did The Rover and Animal Kingdom. This movie is basically the satirical story of Brad Pitt's character, who was a general during the Bush era. It's definitely sort of marketed as going off of like The Big Short sort of style, because I think it's some of the same producers, including Brad Pitt. I wouldn't compare this directly to The Big Short. The Big Short is legitimately like one of my favorite movies of all time. And this wasn't as funny as The Big Short. It definitely sort of hit at that same sort of satire. But it was surprisingly a more sincere movie. I mean, obviously, it's a critique of Brad Pitt's character, who's, you know, a super right-winger, but you also feel sympathetic towards him. And it's, you don't, you know, feel like, oh, this guy's just an asshole who wants to go to war. This is just sort of how he was raised. He doesn't, really belong in this sort of environment anymore because the world is changing and stuff like that. I know some people didn't like sort of the tonal shifts in it, but for me it worked because it's sort of halfway through the movie, it sort of switches from first-person narrative to sort of a more reflective sort of tone. The contrast of drama and comedy worked for me because there's like a super like dramatic scene where some children in the Middle East are brutally murdered by U.S. soldiers. And then there's also a scene with Brad Pitt dancing to like a Lady Gaga song in a club. Everybody's dancing around like, America! I think Dave McCott is a talented enough filmmaker that he can sort of introduce these sort of ideas without beating you over the head with them. But the technical side of it's really well made. The action scenes are pretty, like, intense. I liked a lot of the supporting performances as well. Topher Grace was really good. I like Will Poulter, who plays a soldier. And that's another sort of the shift that happens in the movie. It sort of goes from a more straightforward narrative following one character to becoming more of an ensemble piece in the second half. So I think it's worth watching. It's an interesting movie, and I wish more people saw it, because like if this movie was released by a major studio, there would be like so many fucking think pieces about this. I implore you to check it out, because it is an interesting movie, and I think you'll have some fun with it. And maybe learn some stuff as well. Yeah, I'm gonna go with that. 1922, which is one of the many Stephen King adaptations. Apparently this is just like a great year for Dunkirk movies, John Denver songs, and Stephen King adaptations. It's essentially Telltale Heart with, you know, taking place in 1922 on a farm. And Thomas Jane is the main character of this movie, who he and his teenage son kill his wife. She wants to take his son and move away and sell their farm. And the farm is owned by her parents, so even if they got divorced, he wouldn't be able to keep it. You know, he's a man in 1922, so he's all about having his own land. He thinks that cities are for fools. I'm so glad that the movie didn't stretch the premise. Like, this movie is like an hour 45, which is like the perfect length for something like this. This is, I mean, maybe it could have worked as a short movie as well. Thomas Jane's really great in this movie. I've kind of been waiting for him to have a really good role in a while, because he's sort of one of those actors that seems to be just forgotten by the industry in general. This is a great character piece. He has a ton to do. He's sort of, even in the first half, when he's sort of struggling on whether or not to do this thing, and the consequences that he'll have to face either way, matched with, and then the second half, where he actually has to face those consequences. I mean, y'all know what's gonna fucking happen. I don't know who plays this kid. Again, I'm an asshole, but they had a great back and forth. Their chemistry really worked. I like their father-son dynamic. And there's some great, like, just creepy imagery that, like, feels like I'm reading, like, a Stephen King short. A lot of stuff with cockroaches, and the murder in the movie is pretty brutal, which I enjoy. This list is all about violence. I really like the atmosphere of this movie, really like the suspense, and I like the fact that the suspense continues past the central point of the movie. You know, it could have been just leading up to when he killed his wife, and that could be it. But the second half, for me, was almost at, if not more interesting than the first half, because he's having to grapple with the consequences of what he did, and then his son gets to some other stuff. I don't know, it's a great period piece for that sort of era, and the idea about, you know, I don't want to say masculinity, but the idea about, you know, what land means, people having pride in their land, and the difference between being in a city and being on a farm. There's a really got a lot of great, really social ideas that they sort of explore with the film. And I can't overstate enough how good Thomas Jane is in the movie, because his character's really a despicable person, but at the same time, you totally understand where he's coming from and why he does what he does, even though what he does is terrible. It's a movie that, like, almost like you should be shown in, like, schools and stuff, because, like, if you're, like, in an English class, this is a perfect, like, exploration of, like, metaphors, themes, the foreshadowing. There's a lot of great, like, sort of, it's not groundbreaking in any way, it's just really well done. Alright, my number six is a film called Win It All. I think this movie was at South by Southwest before it hit Netflix. Jake Johnson plays a gambler who is supposed to be protecting this money for a dude, and then ends up gambling it, so of course he has to reform his life and win all the money back before the guy comes and kills him. Another movie, super simple premise that relies on lead performance. And Jake Johnson's great in this movie. I've enjoyed Jake Johnson in movies. Always sort of has these bit roles, though, and this is the first time I've really seen him in a leading role. I mean, that's sort of like safety guaranteed, not guaranteed. And he's great in this. Like, he just feels like a normal dude who, you know, is in over his head and has to, you know, change his life and change the way he approaches things. He has just sort of this very addictive, competitive personality. It's sort of movies about him wrestling with that. When I read the premise, it sounded like, oh, this is going to be like a fun sort of thriller. It's really not. It's basically about this dude who has never really given a fuck about anything and has made a lot of decisions in his life, and he's basically just trying to rectify it. So it's a good crowd pleaser. Jake Johnson is one of those actors that you just end up rooting for because he's just a fun, charismatic dude. So it's a really well-done movie. It's another nice, like, 90 minutes that I would totally recommend. So definitely check out Win It All. So my number five film, Netflix film of 2017, is Wheelman. This movie is essentially Locke meets Drive with Frank Grillo. So Frank Grillo plays a getaway driver, similar to Ryan Gosling in Drive, who is, you know, doing a heist or serving as the driver for a heist. And of course, gets a nail for his head, and there's a mysterious voice talking to him on the phone who is sort of trying to get him to do certain things, and there's something that happens with his daughter. Like Locke, the central gimmick is it's essentially just Frank Grillo in the car the whole time, you know, talking on the phone. But there, I mean, there is sort of those car action sequences. This feels like a great, like, 90s, like, pulp thriller movie. The premise is simple enough. But Frank Grillo gives a really captivating performance. I really believed him as this sort of hardened, badass dude, but he also has some humility to him, so I love that they throw in that thing with his daughter, who he's talking onto the phone, and he's really trying to look out for her, and he's sort of, his marriage is falling apart. So there's a lot of complex things going on with his character, but then when you get to the basic premise of it all, when he's sort of talking to people he's been associated with on the phone, sort of his enemies, it really requires a lot of a performance to do that much and sell that there are so many things happening while just taking place in one location. Jeremy Rush is the director of this film, ironically enough, I guess. I really like the way he staged his action sequences. Clearly, this is a low-budget movie. It's done, like, almost completely practical. Even though that there are these intense sequences, it's still mostly shot from Frank Grillo's perspective, or you're in the car with him. It's essentially breaking the fourth wall without breaking the fourth wall. It's a really effective technique, and I like what they did with it. And I felt that the last, like, 20 minutes had one of the best action sequences I'd seen all year. If this didn't work and it's just Frank Grillo in a car, that could be really boring. But the way, you know, the whole thing is done, when they, you know, combining the things he has to do when he's in the car with the conversations, it's really, really captivating. It's really, really well done stuff. This feels like a great, like, midnight movie sort of thing. My number four is the other Stephen King adaptation I was talking about, and that is Gerald's Game. Holy fuck, it's weird. Carlo Gugino and Bruce Greenwood were like 15 years age difference. Doesn't matter. They play a married couple who, you know, are trying to spice up their marriage. So they go to this sort of remote location. Carlo Gugino's chained to a bed. Her husband dies unexpectedly due to a medical thing, and she has to somehow escape. This movie is one of the most fucked up movies I've seen of the year. It might be the most fucked up movie I've seen since Neon Demon. In general, I feel like I have a pretty good stomach for the sort of, you know, dark material. But there was a scene in this where I literally had to turn away because I was like, oh fuck, this is intense. It's not, you know, disturbing in the sense of something like, I don't know, like Serbian film, which is just like gore and violence, or something like one of the Eli Roth movies, like Green Inferno. It's so consistently trying to shock you that it's sort of, you know, it's ineffective after a while. This movie is a combination of, you know, the visuals, but also, like, the story behind what happens to Carlo Gugino and her backstory and some of the things she went through. There's a lot of flashbacks to her life. And it takes a great actress to handle that material. And I don't know if this qualifies for Oscars or whatever, but I would put Carlo Gugino as one of my best actresses of the year. She was so good in this movie. Again, like I've been talking about, like Frank Grillo, like, it's an isolated location. You need to be compelling as a character and as a performer to sort of engage me in the story. And she is so good at, the shock and the anger and everything that she has to go through. I mean, also, the kid who plays E.T. is in this movie. And he's old now, and holy fuck, this movie will make you not want to rewatch E.T. because... No spoilers, but he done fucked up. I think the ending has been somewhat divisive, but I kind of liked it, and it's one that I think, I haven't rewatched it yet, but I do want to, because I think it's one that warrants further discussion. It's not one I can totally recommend to everybody, because there's some pretty, you know, disturbing stuff in here, but if you're into, like, this, if you're into Stephen King, I think this is one you'll totally dig. I don't want to call it a horror movie. I would say it's a thriller with some horror elements to it. I'm not super familiar with Mike Flanagan's work. In fact, this is the first film I've seen from his. He manages to take sort of this very simple premise and use it as a jumping point to just completely break down, you know, this character's the most vulnerable she's ever been. And you just really get a great sense of her entire life and everything that, you know, led her up to this moment. It's a really dark, interesting movie, and I hope that people recognize Carla Gugino's performance, because she is great in this film. I would totally recommend Gerald's Game. Getting into my top three. My number three is a movie that I won't get into too much, because we already sort of talked about it, and that's Mudbound. You should have a after credits for that, so this is the one time I got Daniel to actually watch a Netflix film. Mudbound's a pretty searing breakdown of racism in the United States. It's one of the more interesting stories of racism, because it's not, you know, the traditional environments, traditionally you sort of see slavery and you sort of see the 1960s movement, but you don't really explore what happens in between, and the fact that just because slavery doesn't exist legally doesn't mean that prejudice doesn't exist. And it's a great epic about two families, and sort of their experiences over time. Arguably the best part of the movie is the relationship between Garrett Hedlund and Jason Mitchell, who are two soldiers that come back from war, and they're both, you know, essentially coming back to the same environment that they left before they went to war. And so sort of that shock of Jason Mitchell, he was a hero at one day, and he comes back and he's just essentially treated like a slave again. A lot of the ideas the movie's grasping at, just the idea that the white family feels that the black family just owes them stuff because they're living on their land. And there's these prejudices that they almost feel second nature to them. And then you get the, you know, fucking guy, Mike from Breaking Bad, who comes in and he's the stereotypical racist grandpa. And the stuff with him at the end is genuinely, again, some of the more disturbing things I've seen this year. So it's a great sort of take on on racism. It's a more complex view than I think it's normally portrayed. The cinematography is fantastic. I really felt like I was there in this environment. And then the combat scenes were really effective too. Like, you don't need a huge budget. You can just show a guy in a cockpit. And that's, you know, him reacting to stuff is, you know, more thrilling than, you know, a ton of explosions and stuff. It's a really well-done movie. Like I said, I won't get into it too much because we already sort of discussed it on after credits. But it's one I totally recommend. And I know it's getting some Oscar buzz for the screenplay and Mary J. Blige's performance, so totally check out Mudbound. My number two Netflix original film of the year is a film called The Discovery, another Sundance movie. Robert Redford plays a scientist who, in the not-so-distant future, has discovered scientific proof of some sort of the afterlife. So there's this suicide epidemic. People just keep killing themselves because they figure, if I know scientifically that there's proof of the afterlife, I'll just kill myself. This movie is a love story between a suicidal woman, played by Rooney Mara, and Robert Redford's son, played by Jason Segel. Now, Jason Segel has really impressed me as an actor. If you haven't seen The End of the Tour, which came out a couple years ago, that really proved that he can do dramatic roles, and he's really great in this. And the relationship between him and Rooney Mara is, again, arguably the best part of the movie, because they're both sort of broken in some ways. You discover why. Rooney Mara's character is suicidal, and you discover sort of the relationship that Jason Segel has with his father and how he's sort of living in his shadow. It's definitely one that I wish more people saw, not just because I think it's a really good movie, but because it's one that I think warrants a lot of discussion. This reminds me a lot of Donnie Darko, in the sense that it's one that, like, when you certain things are revealed, you want to just rewind the movie and see how certain things play in, because the way it deals with time and the concept of what the afterlife really is, this could have been really, really hokey, but the way they do it is really, really cool. If you knew that the afterlife was just waiting for you, you know, would you just, you know, would you live out the rest of your life, even, you know, if your life was great, if your life was terrible? And, you know, it has a lot to say about, like, our faith in science. It doesn't really deal with the religious aspect of it, but just people's conceptions about death and, you know, the value of life. it surprisingly touches on a lot of really interesting concepts without having a real, you know, stake in any one particular argument. I like that the movie sort of actively discusses this stuff openly through the characters, but in the end it's more about the story and the sort of the part of the movie where Jason Segel and Rooney Mara are trying to uncover certain things, and they're sort of, you know, trying to discover this mystery behind a certain thing that happened, is really, really well done stuff. So it's one that I would totally recommend, and I wish more people saw it, because I think it's one that warrants discussion. And I think this is one of those movies like A Midnight Special or an Ex Machina that, you know, over time could be considered a modern sci-fi classic. So, The Discovery, watch it. Alright, so now we're getting to the end of my list. My number one favorite Netflix film came out in 2017, and I'm going to pick one that I saw not that long ago, and that's The Meyerowitz Stories, new and selected, new film from Noah Baumbach. Noah Baumbach's a really interesting filmmaker. He does family dysfunction and just weird characters really well. He did work with Greta Gerwig, did Mistress America, While We're Young, and this might be my favorite film he's done. I mean, While We're Young is pretty great. Mistress America's fucking hilarious. I think this is the perfect, you know, sort of ensemble piece, because it's about a group of really interesting characters who you're invested in their story, but you also, in real life, would never want to hang out with these people because they're all, you know, just, you know, assholes in their own way. Getting to see actors that you wouldn't normally perceive playing these sort of roles really works. Adam Sandler, I've said for a while, he's really good at dramatic roles. And I wish he would do more drama, because he's really good when he does them. He's great in Punch Drunk Love. And I love this, because he sort of gets to play, you know, I don't want to say against type, because he still sort of plays an Adam Sandler sort of character. I mean, the opening scene is him just yelling at a dude in traffic with his daughter next to him as he's just, like, completely raging and losing his mind, which is great to watch. It's hilarious. And then Ben Stiller sort of plays his brother, who's, you know, been more successful, and there's sort of that sibling rivalry, but also Ben Stiller, you know, doesn't feel as close to the rest of the family. Your sister, played by Elizabeth Marvel, who is definitely a more reserved character, sort of the voice of reason against all this, you know, sibling craziness. And then their dad, played by Dustin Hoffman, who, I mean, maybe he's an asshole in real life, he probably is, but I thought he was really funny in this movie. I think if you had a dysfunctional family, this is something that you can just relate to, because, you know, there is an undercurrent of affection between all these characters, and everything they do, in a way, is because of each other. You know, how Dustin Hoffman has so much pride in himself, and he's always, in a way, trying to inspire his kids, but at the same time, you know, he can come off as this arrogant douchebag. Ben Stiller is, you know, trying to prove himself to the rest of the family, or not necessarily prove himself, but he wants to, in a way, he almost wants to distance himself from them. And Adam Sandler, who's always felt like he was, you know, he's in this movie, he's divorced, he's jobless, he feels like a failure in the family. And getting to see him confront his dad about the expectations that he set and the very specific lifestyle that they have, you know, these, you know, sort of higher-end people who live in New York, which, you know, this could have been, like, just the most pretentious thing ever. It's like, oh, it's a bunch of, you know, rich white people in New York, and that's sort of hard to relate to, but I think they did a really good job with it, because each character has a struggle, and then, again, no spoilers, but something is revealed about Elizabeth Marvel's character, which I think could have been really poorly handled in an otherwise comedic movie, but it's really great, and I'm not going to spoil it, but something happens, or it is revealed about what happened at one point to her character, that is done really, really tastefully, and is given a really interesting perspective that you really don't see in terms of how Ben Stiller and Adam Sandler react to it. It's also just really, really fucking funny. Like, there's these random scenes of these super, like, pornographic art films that Adam Sandler's daughter's making in college, and, you know, the family reacting to them, trying to watch these stupid things, is really funny, and Adam Sandler just yelling, and him getting into a fight in front of Ben Stiller, and them trying to, you know, as their father's in the hospital, sort of trying to present his art to a group of people. And then there's these weird celebrity cameos, like Judd Hirsch shows up at one point, Sigourney Weaver. It's a really, really weird movie, but it's really, really charming. And I really fell in love with these characters in a way that I wasn't expecting. it's a movie that I'm sure that you can, you know, write extensive essays about, you know, their relationships and stuff, but for me, I just found it really, really entertaining. Probably one of the better comedies I've seen this year. I don't think, you know, there's been a lot of great comedies, but I laughed a lot at this, and it's not because there's, you know, it was much more of those situations, and it's one in a comedy where, you know, the humor comes from the fact that all these characters are really well fleshed out, which I think they are in this movie. So, my favorite movie of my favorite Netflix film of the year, The My Witch Story's New and Selected. I had a blast with it. That is my list that I struggled through. I'm really tired, so sorry if this is low energy. So I think this is a pretty good representation. I haven't seen The Babysitter because I don't hate myself. I haven't seen Sandy Wexler. At the time that I'm filming this, Bright has not come out yet. The new David Ayer, Will Smith, Max Landis film that looks, you know, just great. I'm curious to see what you guys think, if you've seen any of these movies, if you like them, if there's anything that wasn't on my list that you saw this year on Netflix, definitely let me know about that. And we got our whole 8 days of HalfKocked thing going. I don't know what's next. Nobody tells me things. The most important part is the last two, which is going to be our best movies of the year, or worst movies of the year, and our best movies of the year. If you like this video, please click the like button down below. Also, make sure to subscribe to be the first to know whenever we have new content. We got Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. You can check out my blog if you want. I don't know if I'm going to continue it, but if you want, liamgohan.wordpress.com. It's there. It's up. So we're looking forward to the new year. Cheers, putting suppers and beers, making rain right down like a monsoon. Listen to the bass go boom explosions.